unmute yourself, sir.
Sir, please unmute, sir.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. শোনা যাচ্ছে?
হ্যাঁ স্যার শোনা যাচ্ছে। তাহলে শুরু করছি স্যার।
হ্যাঁ।
ওকে। অর্চনদা?
অর্চনদা, আর ইউ রেডি?
এভরিথিং ইজ রেডি ফর মাই পার্ট। ইউ মে স্টার্ট।
ওকে।
ওকে 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 ওকে। আই এম স্টার্টিং। ওকে।
वेदान्तेषु यमाहुरेक पुरुषं व्याप्यास्थितं रोदसी यस्मिन्नीश्वर इत्यनन्न विषय शब्दो यथार्थाक्षर अन्तर्यश्च मुमुक्षुभिर्नियमिता प्राणादिभिर्मृग्यते स्थानो स्थिर भक्ति योग सुलभो निःश्रेयसायास्तु वा।
नमः सभाभ्यः। गुड आफ्टरनून ऑनरेबल प्रिंसिपल सर शेख शाहजहान अली, IQAC कोऑर्डिनेटर डॉक्टर अर्चन नंदी, द एमिनेंट रिसोर्स पर्सन्स, द पार्टिसिपेंट्स फ्रॉम द कंट्री पार्ट्स, माय कलीग्स एंड स्टूडेंट्स, इट इज नोन टू यू ऑल that the Department of Sanskrit and Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Vijayendralal College, Krishnanagar, has jointly organized 2 days national level webinar on Indian concept of hygiene, ancient and modern perspective. Today is the first day of this webinar. Today we shall hear the lectures from 3 resource persons, Professor Gopabandhu Mishra, Dr. Sukumar Chattopadhyay and Dr. Kushal Banerjee. In present time, we are facing and spending the embarrassing and suffocating moments during the outbreak of COVID-19. In this unbearable and indescribable situation, which is going on prolonged since 4 months, our department has taken an initiative to organize such online academic work for our mental peace and freshness, thinking about the way to get rid of the bad effect of such pandemic. With inspiration and motivation of our respected principal sir, on behalf of our Department of Sanskrit, I convey my gratitude from the core of my heart, especially to Dr. Archan Nandi, coordinator IQAC, for his extraordinary and unequal effort and dedication for the success of the webinar organized. Thanks to all of you. Today's webinar will be inaugurated by Sheikh Shahjahan Ali, Honorable Principal of Vijayendralal College. I earnestly request you, sir, to please inaugurate the program representing the topic of the webinar and deliver the welcome address. Sir, please.
Namaskar. A very good afternoon to all the delegates, my fellow colleagues and students. On behalf of my college, I welcome all the resource persons from the country parts, Professor Gopabandhu Mishra, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sri Somnath Sanskrit University, Gujarat, Dr. Sukumar Chattopadhyay, Assistant Professor, Department of Sanskrit, Banaras Hindu University, Dr. Kushal Banerjee, Department of Pharmacology, College of Medicine and JNM Hospital, Kollani, Dr. Anindya Bandyopadhyay, Assistant Professor and Head in Sanskrit, University of Kollani, Professor Vishnupada Nanda, Professor and Ex-Head in Education, Jadavpur University, and Mrs. Padda Rai, Assistant Professor in Sociology, Bakuda Christian College. We are grateful to them as they not only agreed to share their valuable thoughts with us and shed their lights of expertise over the relevant topics. It is indeed a privilege for the Vijayendralal College Poriwar, Krishnanagar Nodia, to organize a 2 days seminar on the topics Indian concept of hygiene, ancient and modern perspective. I cordially congratulate the Department of Sanskrit and Internal Quality Assurance of my college for organizing a webinar with such a relevant topics in the present scenario. It is quite noticeable to us that the extensive effect of coronavirus COVID-19 is the most discussed topic in entire world in the present scenario. Various research work and discussion are going on among the fraternity of scientists and doctors to get rid of the bad effect of the fatal virus. In this situation, the modes of maintaining proper hygiene have come up as a crucial point of discussion. But the term hygiene is not such an undisclosed topics or methods at all. It has been evidently proved in ancient scripture that there is an importance and priority of hygiene in ancient Indian tradition. From the Vedic literature to modern medical science, it has been extensively pronounced the proper way of maintaining hygiene, which can keep away and resist any kind of disease. Currently, in this pandemic situation, people have been discussing about the outbreak of coronavirus and its fatal effect. But we shall be discussing about the hygiene, which is the easiest and finest method to eradicate the spread of the deadly virus. Our webinar will set the light to four main target points. Firstly, the concept, definition, and method of hygiene deficit in ancient scripture, Ayurveda, Dharmashastra, etc. in Vedic tradition, and how these are effective in the present pandemic situation. Secondly, the concept of hygiene in modern medical science and its utility for eradicating the effect of pandemic. Thirdly, in modern sociological aspect, the acceptability of the term hygiene and the role of society in the trend of evolution of the concept hygiene. Fourthly, as there is a great importance of mind for anyone overall fitness, the word hygiene not only denotes the physical hygiene, but also the mental hygiene. So the present crisis PO, how can we take care of mental health? This will also be the life of the webinar. I hope our distinguished guests and experts through their presentation will provide us a detailed and clear concept of this relevant and important topics. On behalf of my college, I once again welcome all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful inauguration and enlightening welcome address. I think it is now clear to all that what we intend to discuss through these 2 days webinar. However, there is no need of wastage of times. Now we will enter the technical session for listening to the valuable lectures from three eminent scholars. This is our humble request to all the participants to mute their audio option and avoid to press the present now button also during the session. If they have any questions regarding the lectures, they would write it to the chat box only. Those will be answered in our question and answer session. Now, I would like to request Mrs. Sushmita Niyogi, faculty member, Department of Sanskrit, for taking the responsibility as the coordinator of three technical sessions. Mrs. Niyogi, please.
Thank you, Dr. Arijit Gupta. Thanks to the principal, sir, all my colleagues, and the participants too. Firstly, we welcome Professor Gopibandhu Mishra, Honorable Vice Chancellor, of Sri Somnath Sanskrit University, Veerabhil, Gujarat, for delivering the keynote lecture. Professor Mishra was a former student of Rashtriya Sanskrit Sansthan, New Delhi, and Vishwabharati University, Shantiniketan, for his UG and PG. He pursued his PhD and D.Litt from Patna University and VKS University, Agra, respectively. Professor Mishra had been teaching in Maharaja College and later in Sanskrit VKS University, Agra, from 1980 to 2004. Later, he has embraced the Department of Sanskrit, Faculty of Arts, Banaras Hindu University since 2002. He has served his academic duty as a visiting professor of Sanskrit in Sorbonne Nouvelle University, Paris, from October 2010 to July 2012. More than 30 doctoral works have been completed under this supervision. Totally, more than 25 books are edited and written by him. Now, he is in charge of Honorable Vice Chancellor of Sri Somnath Sanskrit University, Veerabhil, Gujarat. We are very much fortunate to have him as a today's keynote speaker. I am requesting Professor Gopinath Mishra to deliver his valuable speech.
Sarve bho namo namaha. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are not clearly audible.
Yes. Okay. Om Satchidananda Rupaya Vishwapatyadi Hetave Tapatraya Vinashaya Sri Krishnaya Vayam Namaha. Saurashtra-deshe viśate-tiramme jyotirmayam chandratalavatansam bhakti-pradānāya kripāvatirnam tangso-munātam saranam prapatte. Respected principal of Dvijendranath College, Sheikh Shahjahan Ali Sahib, the organizers of this webinar, Dr. Arijit Gupta of Sanskrit Department, Dr. Susmita, and other organizers, the scholars, our colleague Dr. Sukumar Chattopadhyay ji from BHU, and participants, among them whom I recognize, Dr. Manju Kumari ji, Dr. Vihaspati Bhattacharya ji, and Sri Debashish Jaina, and many others whom I recognize, and otherwise also who are present here and who are participating in different way through the live telecast of this seminar. I am very fortunate to be with you in this occasion and to express something about the topic which is very much relevant today in this pandemic COVID-19. Now I would like to present this my PPT. Is it possible here? Because I am not acquainted with this Google Meet. Is it possible? Is it with me PPT, Arijit?
Yes, sir. Please click on the present now button on the right
and
side.
And then
select the option that
a window.
entire window, entire screen, entire screen.
Screen. Acha. And then, okay.
And then select the window and presenting select. Will be started.
Select the window.
Yes, sir.
Pro. Then where is Windows? Share. Acha. Could not follow it.
Firstly, you have to click your entire screen button.
Entire. You present now. Entire screen.
Yes, sir.
And then.
Then share. Yes.
Click on share button. Yes, sir.
And then.
Then you'll have to open the PPT file.
Minimize the present window and open the PPT or PDF file.
Is it visible now?
No, sir.
Is it visible now, my presentation? No?
No, sir. Not yet.
But I am opening share. Then where to go? So share. Does not reflect anything. I am opening here. So where to go?
The presenting will be shown, sir, on the screen.
No, share is there, and after share, nothing is coming up.
Have you properly clicked on the share button? I think it has not been shared.
So it is in my PC, but how to share it? Actually,
I think there are some technical glitches.
Okay.
So that's why this is not happening. This is
not possible here. Actually, we are habituated with Google Meet and WebEx and Zoom otherwise.
In Zoom it is much easier.
So should I make it cancelled? Once again, I should try. Present
okay,
now.
Okay, sir. Take your time.
Present now on
okay,
like Chrome, a window. Should I open a window? No.
Sir, you may share the entire screen, and then you have to press. Then you'll have to press share button.
I am pressing it.
It's not working, sir.
But it is not working. It is share is not reflecting anything.
Yes,
that is the problem. Your screen with Chrome wants to share the contents of your screen with Meet.
Yeah. You will have to give the permission. You will have to give the permission, sir, to Chrome.
Nothing is being reflected here.
Your screen is Chrome is trying to share something, and there must be something yes or no. Then you will have to give the permission, sir.
No.
Yes, sir. Now it's presenting. Your screen is shared.
Now it is coming.
Yes. Yes. And now the PPT is also being is visible. PPT is visible, sir. Yes, sir.
All is visible, sir. Okay.
Yes.
Then, Palasiddhi. Thank you very much for this Palasiddhi. So, let me go on. First of all, I would like to present the concept of Indian scriptures, in which it is reflected, it is said, explained in different terms, that is Ayurveda. So Ayurveda, it is very well known to us, not only to us now, to everybody of this world. They are now propagating this Ayurveda. And when we speak of Ayurveda, the word is a compound one. It is Ayuhu and Veda. Ayurvedaha, Ayushaha Vedaha. It may be of Veda knowledge of Ayush. Ayush or Ayuhu Vindanti Anena, by which we can get Ayu. Or third meaning may be there. Ayuhu Asmin Vidyate, in which Ayu remains. And then, if it is like that, Ayurveda, then the question arises, what is Ayu? Ayu is generally translated as age. Not only age, what is the concept behind Ayush? It is told in Charaka, Sarira Indriya Sattvatma Sanyogo Hari Jeevitam Nityagas Chanubandhascha Paryayai Rayu Rutsyate. These all are told Ayus. These four terms are there. So first of all it is Sarira Indriya Sattvatma Sanyogaha Ayu. That means in this body, human body, these four things are there. Sharira is the parts of body, hands and legs and everything. And then Indriya, the organs, both Karmendriya and Jnanendriya. And Sattva, Sattva means here the mind, which controls all these organs. And fourth one is Atma, which is translated in general soul. It may be a bigger one or a greater one, but let the soul be treated here as a translated form of Atma. So these four are united in one system, that is the body we are having. And the all the unity of all these four is called Ayu. How it is? Etymologically, it has been treated like this. A means samanta, fully, chetanaya yunakti, which connects with the consciousness. That is Ayu, yunakti. It is from the physical part, this explanation stands. And another, from the metaphysical part, another explanation stands. A samanta chetana yujyate samadhiyate. By this force, in a totality, in which we can count our all the courses, all the cases, That have been depicted as Annamaya Kosha, Pranamaya Kosha, Manomaya Kosha, Vijnanamaya Kosha, and Anandamaya Kosha. All are united, and after the unification, it leads to Samadhi. Chetana, consciousness, leads to Samadhi by this one. By that one, that is called Ayu, which makes this arrangement, by which this consciousness goes up and up and up and unifies total system and leads to Samadhi. What is the goal of this life? That is called that instrument which causes all these things, that is called Ayu. Next meaning, another Ayu. Next meaning of Ayu, it is Tad Ayu Chetana Dhritihi. Tad Ayu Chetana Dhritihi. Charaka says. But what we went through this sloka, Sharira Indriya Sattvatma Sanyogaha Thari Jeevitam. Second one is Thari. Thari. Ayu is called Thari. Thari is Ayu. How it is Thari? because it is dharayati shariram putikan gantum na dadati. That which keeps this body in very pure or perfect, so that it does not smell otherwise, or it does not that is decay. Shariram dharayati nityameva sharire asankhya koshanam shiryamane satyapi galanabhavah durgandhabhavasch jayate. Even if there are many cells, asankhya kosha, there are many several cells are there in our body and they are decaying always, still there is no decay, there is no bad smell. Till this ayu remains with us, it keeps this these all the things intact, so that it does not decay. To keep this dilapidating condition away, so it keeps the total parts intact. That's why it is thari, ayuhu thari. Third one is jivitam. Jivitam is clear. Jivati pranan dharayati. It is jivita. We are, as far as ayu is there, even if we are in a person is in a ICU or in ventilated way, in a bad condition, in a very injured condition, still he is, his ayu is there, he is called jivayati, he is jivita, he is alive. So to make us, which makes us alive, that is called ayu, jivitam. And fourth one is nityagaha. Nityagaha means sarirasya kshanikatvena gacchati kalasya pratyekam kshanena sambhuya atati. We know the stage of our body changes from the childhood and youth and old age. It changes and changes. Kshanikatvena gacchati kalasya pratyekam. It is changes always, it changes, but ayu remains always inside it. So that is called nityaga. It remains permanent till we are alive. So it is called nityaga. I am sorry, it was fifth one, that is anubandhaha. Anubandha means anubatnati ayu. Apara shariradi sanyoga rupataya. Jivanam sharira indriya atma manasa sanjoga rupena pramasa purva apara rupena padnati. It relates, it binds, it makes us bound. Even childhood goes away, youth comes, but we never feel it. It is a process of tied up, bound. We are bound, the system is bound. In this, that's why it is ayu, and this work is done by ayu. That is why it is called anubandha. So it is sharira indriya atma sanyoga, it is thari, it is jivita, it is nityaga and anubandha. And then Charaka says tadayu chetana driti, which makes us all the keeps us intact with the consciousness, chetana, that is charaka, that is ayu. A garbhat marana parjantam chetanaya sattvameva. Still from the womb of our mother till the death, the consciousness remains, and it is because of this ayu. So ayu is a brother, is having a brother aspect for us from our Indian concept. And then we come to the point swastha, and hygiene, swasthata. Ayurveda, our Veda, the knowledge of Ayu, and whatever the Ayurveda has been explained in the first slide, it is not only the physical, the remedy of diseases or the physical fitness, it is about a style, lifestyle. We are having pariskruta jivana shaili swasthasya in two ways, a lifestyle which has two ways. One way is swasthasya swasthya rakshanam. Who is healthy and well, his wellness to be is to be kept intact. Swasthya rakshanam. And second is aturasya rogopashamanam. Who is ill, his illness should be cured. So those two things are depicted, are described. Two ways have been meant explained in Ayurveda. Both the ways. Before the disease, no such disease should come to us. For that also Ayurveda explains, guides us. And even some disease coming, like this epidemic disease or some other disease also, so then it should be cured. Both the ways have been explained in Ayurveda. Not only after the disease attacks us, the treatment only is not told here. It is before the disease to be well, intact, and to keep this body till the death intact and well. It is also depicted there. So swastha, what is swastha? There are two words, swastha and sustha. In North India, generally we ask a question, aap swastha hain? Swastha, swasmin tishthati. Who is very happy? Himself, he is swastha. And sustha is shobhanam tishthati. He is keeping very well, leading his life very well. That is called sustha. A little difference is there, but two words are being used. In eastern part of India, in West Bengal and Odisha also, that generally it is asked sustha. Sustha hai, sustha ache. So swastha is used in northern part of India. But here sustha says sustha. Who is sustha? It may be the same synonym of swastha. He said, samadoshaha, samagnishcha, samadhatu malakriyaha, prasannatmendriyamanaha, sustha iti abhidhiyate. Samadoshaha, samagnihi, samadhatu malakriyaha, prasannatmendriyamanaha. These four things are needed for a person who will be called sustha. That means perfect, very good, without any disease. Then it is explained, dosaha. Dosaha should be sama, sama dosaha. Dosaha should be equally be in our body. Dosaha are three in number, vataha, pittam, kaphascha dosaha. Sarirapakarshakaha dosaha. Those who make us ill, they are called dosha. So they are three, as you know, vata, pitta, kapha. All diseases are coming from these three types of dosha. So if the doshas are balanced, three doshas are balanced, then a person is sustha. Next is agnihi. Agni, jatharagni, as we know, we are having the power, fire inside, which cooks our food and makes the blood and everything good, perfect inside. So that is called also agni. So that should be sama agnihi. It should not be more or less. If it is cooking well, then our digestion is well and everything is going perfectly. Then a person is called sustha, sama agnihi. And next, samadhatu malakriyaha. Dhatu, mala and kriya. These three must be sama, equally. Atma, equilibrium of those three things is needed. So what are they? Dhatu. Dhatu are sapta, seven in number. Rasa, astrik, that means blood. Mansa, medaha, asti, majja, shukra. These three saptas, seven are called dhatu. If these are equally working perfectly, then the person is perfect. Well, and Mala, as we know, Mala is inside. That is that then Kriyaha. Kriya, whatever we do, Jagaranam, Swapaha, Swasanam, Chalanam, Ityadaya. Many things that works we do. If these works are done perfectly in a equally, then a body is susta. And fourth one is very clear, prasanna atma indriya manaha. Atma should be prasanna, good, perfect, present, and indriya also, all the organs, and equally our mind, as our principle, respected principle has described. Not only we are not only explaining the physical treatment or physical fitness, the mental fitness is equally treated important in for our life. So it is prasanna atma indriya. When we call it a person is susta, happy or perfect, that means he is perfect in his body and his mind also. So these are the things. Then who is niroga? Without disease, who is? This has been explained. That is Nisusruta, it is told that Naro Hitahara Vihara Sevi Samikshakari Vishayeshu Asakta Tata Sama Satya Parahachamavan Aptopa Sevi Bhavati Aroga. Both are synonym. Niroga Nir Nasti Rogaha Jasyasaha Nirogaha or Na Rogaha Jasyasaha Saha Aroga. Who has no disease? That is called Niroga Athava Aroga. Both are same. So who is Aroga? It is called, it is depicted by Susruta, who is Hita Ahara Vihara Sevi. It is who takes his food in a balanced way and who moves, who makes physical exercise also. Duttahara Viharasya Viharasya Dutta Chistasya Karmakrit. Dukta Supna Babudhasya Yogu Bhavati Dukkaha. In our Gita, it is told that Natyasnatastu Yogasthi Natyikanta Manasnatra Natyati Supna Shirasya Jagrato Naiva Chardu. Who is doing his work, his sleep and his work without taking rest, and it is any excess of this food and rest and sleep, which whatever we can say, it is definitely creates trouble. When it is yukta hara viharasya yukta chestasya karmasu yukta supna bhavodasya yogo bhavati dukkha, as Gita says. So it is also in Susruta, when it is hitahara, which is very useful, that sort of food should be taken, and physical exercise, that is called vihara, to move or to do physical exercise. Samikshakari, what to do, how to live. The lifestyle should be with a view, with a vision, with a mood, a positive aspect should be there. Vishayeshu asakta, and which is not attached with these mundane things. And Data, who gives, it is very peculiar. We can mark it here that it is not never told in any part, any scripture of this world, in other than Sanskrit, Ayurveda. Who gives, who donates, he becomes aroga. Donating something makes a person very perfect or well. It is different. That means when one donates something, he is very positive. He gives a positive view and very helping attitude for others. That makes the person very perfect himself also. It is very peculiar in this description. Samaha, who is very equal with others. Satya paraha, who is a lover of satya, truth. And kshamavan, who is doing kshama. And aptopasevi, another thing very peculiar, who serves the elders, the teachers,
elders. Apta upasevi cha bhavati aroga. This part is never told in any literature or any medical science other than this Ayurveda here. And in Garuda Purana, a very, very peculiar question asked by Hanuman Garuda. Garuda Purana, Garuda asks Hanumantari, Koruk, three times. Kah Aruk, who is disease less? That means who is well. Then he says, Hanumantari answers, Hitabhuk, Mitabhuk, Ritubhuk, Shakabhuk, Shatapadagami, Vamashai, Abhijita Mutra Purishaha, Bhagavan, Soruk, Sah Aruk. Three times question was asked. So three times he says, Soruk. Who he is well or diseaseless? Who is Hitabhuk? Who takes his food, whatever is useful for the body? And Mitabhuk, who takes a food, measured quantity of food. And Ritubhuk, according to this season, Ritubhuk. And Shakabhuk, who does not take Shaka. And Shatapadagami, who after food walks 100 feet, 100 by foot. And then Vamashayi, who takes rest with his left side. Abhijita Mutra Purisha, who controls his Mutra, Abhijitana, who never controls this Mutra the Purisha, he is Aruk. So Niroga regarding Swasthata, it is told here. I am going to conclude my things because it is the one part that is Indian scriptures have already explained, and this hygiene, as you know nowadays, it is the word from French hygiene, and it means basically it is meaning good for the health, healthful, sound, salutary, well wholesome, and ancient Greek religion, it is personification of health, cleanliness and hygiene. So everything, you can see very well that hygiene, the word or the use of in the modern ways, it covers even the World Health Organization says hygiene refers to conditions and practices that help to maintain health and prevent the spread of diseases. So maintaining health, it never says here mental health or health of a person inside, only to maintain the health, physical health, and then to prevent the disease like this nowadays we are facing. And hygiene is a concept related to cleanliness, health and medicine, whatever nowadays it is explained. Definitely it is hygienic, life should be hygienic, but it only covers this outward hygienic, physical hygienic treatment or way of life. It is as well related to personal and professional care practices in medicine and everyday life settings. Hygiene practices are employed as preventive measures to reduce the incidence and spreading of disease. What we are doing now for this epidemic COVID-19, that to reduce the incidence and to reduce the spreading of this disease, we are doing a lot. That's what we've done. It is very well defined, and the measures have been told in different many ways. Many things have been told, we are practicing also. But in our Ayurveda, in Indian concept, it covers the mental things also. What have been now, I tried to show those things, not comparing with this modern thought, with the traditional thought, because you are very well, you are intelligent and very knowledgeable persons who are attending this webinar. You can very well see what our observation and how it is all pervasive, all inclusive perception we are having in our Indian concept regarding hygiene. is very clear and transparent. So now the even the World Health Organization and other countries also are following or thinking to follow this system that has been told and depicted in our Ayurveda. I am very happy and very indebted, like also that I have been called here and to I have been told to participate and to express something about this. Although it is not directly related to my study, but I tried to express, to present something before you, and it is I am highly obliged to this institution, Vedanath College, and to the organizers for this kind invitation, and with the thanks to everybody. Just I am here ending my expression and presentation. Thank you very much. Dhanyavadaha. Namo namaha. Jayatu Sanskritam. Jayatu Bharat.
धन्यवादः साधु उक्तं महोदयः भवतां भाषणेन वयं पूर्णतया संवृत्ताः दीप्ताः जाता इति निष्प्रचयम् आयुर्वेदविषये सर्वेषां संस्कृतभिन्न क्षेत्रियाणां ज्ञानपरिधि अस्मिन् अवसरे विस्तार्यते इति सर्वे सम्मता इति मन्यामहे थैंक यू वेरी मच देयर इज नो डाउट इट हैज एनलाइटन्ड आवर माइंड एंड एनरिच आवर इंटेलेक्ट with your lecture. Thank you, sir. Now we are entering our first question answer session. We are seeing in chat box there are some questions from different aspect. First question from Mr. Shantu Vishwas, faculty member, Department of Education, Dijendralal College. He asked, how can we transform ourselves from knowledge to wisdom through panchakosha, that is five layers of the human existence?
Generally it has been told also in same, that is in a yoga system and in Gita also, abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha krihyate. It is the practice and vairagya, filling up vairagya inside and outside practice. I am feeling this change, because definitely it is a evolutionary, that is a theory of evolution. It is going on and on. Consciousness is growing. We have come to this point to know, to observe something and to recognize this something, what is inside, what is the quality inside, and how the Annamaya Kosha is different from Pranamaya Kosha. When generally all living beings, including human being also, generally it happens Annamaya Kosha prevails also always. It is a major part, because the total we can observe also the total, for example, the weight of this body, this weight of this body is of this that is flesh and that your blood and other parts. The soul has no weight. So this Annamaya Kosha is very much prevailing always. But we can feel prana and mana and vijnana. It is due to by the practice, feeling it, and to do more practice to be positive always. When positive aspects prevail, then this role of all the koshas, it becomes open. I would like to quote in Shantiniketana, my Gurukula. It is written, you might have many persons this session might have visited there, Chatim Tala. Tini, Amar Praner Aram, Moner Shanti, Atmar Ananda. Tini, Amar Praner Aram, Moner Shanti, Atmar Ananda. The same thing, it rolls differently. When we are that is Pranayama, where we are really greatly getting food and other things, we are getting aram. It is a matter of prana. And dhana is we are very in a peaceful mood. We are very in a luxury mood, luxurious mood. It is about mana. And when it is pleasure, something different, something unexplainable, inexplicable, that is the matter of atma. We can very well observe, but we must be positive. We must be accepting everything, not negating anything from any of any part of this world. Then it will help us, I think.
Thank you very much, sir. The another question from the side of Dr. Marufa Khatun, faculty member, Department of Philosophy, Vijayan Dolal College. She has asked, sir, do you think that Patanjali Yoga and Charaka Samhita will show the perfect path way to overcome the present pandemic situation?
Right, this pandemic, I think it is very, that is a very practical question. This pandemic, my fellow scholar, this is not only the first pandemic of this world. Many types of pandemic have come also and will come also. It is going on and because we are the causes of this type of pandemic. So when we lead our life in a perfect manner, this type of pandemic or otherwise, it will automatically, it will be vanished, or it will be appearing in a different way. That means it will be less attacking. What we need, it is bound, that is, it is a must. Something will go against our survival, against our happiness, against our willingness. It will happen definitely. But what we say, sarve bhavantu sukhina, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani prashyantu ma kasya dukkha bhava bhavet. What we say and what we pray and what we do, that let it be very less in quantity and less attacking for the total humanity. So when we practice all these things said by yoga, sutra, yoga, Patanjala yoga and Charaka Sutra and the sages they have expressed, then the attacks will be less. It will never happen that the world will be free of this any sort of epidemic or this pandemic. It has been, it will be also, but it will be less if our life is led in a positive and a different manner, led by our, said by our, explicated by our sages and forefathers.
Dhanyavad, Mahodaya. We are highly obliged with your valuable and wonderful way of presentation. Now, without any delay, we shall enter our next technical session. Mrs. Niyogi, please proceed.
Okay. Now we are entering the next technical session with the lecture of our second research person, Dr. Shukumar Chattopadhyay, Assistant Professor in Transport Faculty of Arts, Benares Hindu University. Being a former student of University of Bardon, Dr. Chattopadhyay completed his UG, PG and PhD degree from the same university. He has the research experience of 20 years as a research assistant, research officer, senior research officer in Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, mainly engaged in the editing work of Pola Kastoki, a next session of fundamental concepts of Indian arts. He joined as an assistant professor in the Department of Sanskrit, Benares Hindu University in 2008 to Queen's University on. Now he has been teaching or supervising the students and scholars of Sanskrit delegates. It is our great pleasure to have him as a resource person for today's webinar. He will shed the light about the concepts of hygiene in Vedic tradition. Sir, I am requesting you to prepare your lecture to the participants.
Om Bhat करने विष्णुयाम देवा पत्रं पश्ये माक्षमेरयत् त्राह स्थिरैरङ्गै सुष्ठुवंशस्तनूभिर् व्यशेम देवहितं यदायुः ॐ शान्तिः 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 मोस्ट् रेस्पेक्टेड् हाई चांसलर एंड कीनोट स्पीकर ऑफ दिस वेबिनार प्रोफेसर गोपबंधु मिश्रजी respected principal of Gijendralal College, Sheikh Shahjahan Ali sir, and the organizers of this webinar, joint convener, Dr. Arijit Gupta and Dr. Archan Nandi, and magnanimous scholars, students, and participants of this webinar on Indian concept of hygiene, ancient and modern perspective. I am very glad to present my speech on the concept of hygiene in Vedic tradition before this galaxy of scholars. Many thanks for the same to the organizer of this webinar on contemporary topic. At the very outset of this topic, first a question arises. What do we mean by this hygiene? Because before entering to the hygiene in Vedic tradition, we have to know the basic concept of hygiene. Though due to the present pandemic, most of us are aware with this term hygiene. Still, to clear this concept, I would like to present an overview of the term hygiene with modern understanding, and then which would be helpful to know the concept of hygiene in Vedic tradition. The term, keynote speaker also focused on the same, on the origin of this term. The term hygiene in English language is admitted in 1676 AD, coming from the French term hygiene, meaning good for health or healthy. Actually, the term is originated from the Greek word hygiene, traced from the Greek deity Hygieia, a symbol of health, hygiene, and cleanliness. In fact, hygiene is a set of practices followed by human being for the preservation of good health associated with our body. According to World Health Organization, hygiene refers to conditions and practices that help to maintain health and prevent the spreading of diseases. So hygiene means prevention of illness and maintenance of health, promotion of promotion of sanitary system, sanitary practices, especially of household and communities. It is always related cleanliness, related to cleanliness, health and medicine, as well as personal care and professional care. Same hygiene practices might not be acceptable to every culture. Hygiene is a branch of science that deals with the promotion and prevention of health. It may be added to every sphere of our life. Hygiene impacts in or impacts of hygiene is noticed especially on health of livelihood and hygiene, and now people are aware of safe sanitation and hygiene key for pandemic COVID-19. Washing of hands, mouth and feet, using of mask are noticed as a sign of hygiene consciousness of people. Due to this pandemic, we are also familiar with the terms of medical hygiene like isolation or quarantine, sterilization of surgical instruments, protective clothing, barriers, masks, gowns, caps, eyewear, and gloves, disposal of medical waste, ethanol-based sanitization, scrubbing up, and hand washing. So we are familiar with these terms. The reasons behind this hygiene consciousness are very expedient or proper. All the daily practices related with hygiene are very essential. First, taking bath. In India, regular bath is most essential to eradicate foul smell of our body due to action of bacteria on sweat. Washing hands with hand washing after using toilet, before preparing or serving food, before and after eating food, after touching persons infected by cold, etc., or infectious disease, after handling pets and domestic animals, etc., as this hand washing removes the harmful germs. Third, brushing or cleaning teeth in morning and after meals, as it removes food particles remaining in between the teeth. Fourth, rinsing mouth after taking food or meal, as it removes food particles and foul smell or bad breath. Similarly, wearing of washed and clean clothes also protect us from harmful germs. Sanitation is also a related concept, as it takes steps to promote disposal of waste, solid as well as liquid wastes of both man and an animal, all hazardous wastes from hospitals, industries, etc., avoiding open defecation and maintenance of toilets for better healthy living of human being. We should not compare the Indian concept of hygiene from the viewpoint of ancient and modern to dishonor our ancestors, because it depends on the necessity of living being of that particular time and situation. Necessity is the mother of invention. When a man understood the necessity of hygiene as prevention of health, he became more conscious to follow the good practices for better living. In ancient time, people lived in a less polluted area with enjoying of fresh elements like air, water, etc. But in present world, five gross elements, ether, air, fire, water, and soil are polluted, contaminated, and unsafe for healthy living being. It is very interesting to note that not a single occurrence of toilet is noticed in the entire Vedic Sanhitas. It may be due to two reasons. Either it was treated as indecent to mention in sacred scriptures, or people used to defecate in a distant open area from dwelling places. Vedic people used to move in a distant area, in a long distance, to relieve from the dangers of contamination of diseases due to defecation. Nobody wants to suffer from any disease. In Bengali language, the term asukh is used for disease. Ease means comfort, happiness. Hence, disease means unhappiness, discomfort. Vedic people believe in three types of purification: physical, kayik, verbal, vachik, and mental, manasik. Tapaskarma Dharma Sutra gives importance of direction relating with cleanliness. And according to this text, one should take meals facing the east, defecate facing the south, urinate facing the north, and wash feet facing the west. Prangmukho anyani bhunjita ucchare dakshinamukha udangmukho mutrankurya pratyapado anijanamapi. For cleaning the teeth, taking twigs of trees like neem, etc., ancient people used to utter the Vedic words Ayur Valam Yaso Varjah Praja Pasun Vasunicha Brahma Prajyam Cha Medhan Cha Tvangno Dehi Vanaspate. By brushing with this mantra, people pray for long life, strength, success, radiance, subjects and animals, wealth, intellect, knowledge and memory. Ancient people different concept of hygiene as per their necessity. Ancient people had different concept of hygiene as per their necessity and situation. Maintenance of routine life, awakening at dawn, early morning breakfast, avoid contamination with others' saliva by sharing food with others as it is unhygienic, not talking while eating, practice of cooking in earthen utensils, avoid stocking of prepared meals for the whole day, early dinner, eating hygienic foods with hands as per Shastric tradition. It is extremely healthy practice as five fingers together form a mudra for activating sensory organs. Manusmriti imposes some restrictions for urinating and defecation in chapter 4. Na mutraṁ pati purivita, na bhasmani na gopraje, na phalapriste na jale, na chityang na cha parvati, na jirne devayatane, na palimike kadachana, na sasatvesu gartesu, na gacchannapi nasthitah, na naditiram asadhya, na cha parvatam astake, vayuagni vipramadityam apa pasams tathaivaga, na kadachana kurvita, bin mutrasya visarjanam. So that is, one should not urinate and defecate on path, cowshed, water, temple, etc. Vedic seers were conscious about the hygiene for diseaseless and healthy long life. According to them, the basis of hygiene lies in the purity of five gross elements: ether, wind, or air, fire, water, and earth or soil. Vedas are the most ancient source of different streams of knowledge that includes the knowledge of physiology, different diseases, their root causes, nidana, symptoms, and method of curing. From the Vedic literature, we get a complete knowledge of human body, its illness and treatment, with the description of various medicinal plants as remedy of diseases, proper uses of water, air, food, etc. Vedic seers consider the body as a conglomeration of the modification of five gross elements, Mahabhuta, earth, water, fire, air and ether. The modifications of five elements are called dhatus. Seven bodily dhatus, as our keynote speaker already focused on the same, seven bodily dhatus are rasa, rakta, mangsa, med, asti, majja, sukra. Three types of treatment is admitted in the Atharva Veda. As for example, Asuri Chikitsa, the surgery, Manusi Chikitsa by medicinal plants, and Daivi Chikitsa, sacrifice, meditation, exercise, etc. Atharva Veda says that body should be free from diseases. Sva kshetre anamiva viraja. According to the Rig Veda, physician is called Bhishak, originated from the root Bhishaj, to treat. Bhishajyati. Bhishak tamang tva Bhishajan shrenomi. Bhishaj or Bhishaj means medicine. Four types of medicines are mentioned in the Rig Veda: Atharvani, Angirasi, Daivi, and Manusi. Atharvani, Rangirasi, Daivi, Manusajauta, Oshadhaya Prajayanti, Yadatvam, Pranam, Jinnasi. Vedic seers were conscious about the hygiene to maintain a diseaseless and healthy long life. They realized that the root of the hygiene lie in the purity of five gross elements. For good health need five purification and proper maintenance of sound, air, water, food and fire. Out of the five gross elements, three are most essential for good health and hygiene. These are air, fire, water, which are related with the Tridosha concept of Ayurveda, Vata, Pitta and Kapha. Atharvaveda mentions five classes of diseases, out of which three are related with air, fire and water. The disease produced by water is called Abhraja, produced by air is Vataja, and produced by fire causing burning or dryness is shushma. Shushpa or shushma. Yo abhraja vataja jasya shushma vanaspatin svachatang parvatangscha. Here lies the fundament basis of Tridosha concept of Ayurveda. Ayurvedic treatment is totally based on the doctrine of Tridosha. Vata, Pitta and Kapha. Susruta refers to a school who considers the structure or constituent of human body as elemental, bhautiki. Among the five elements, three elements, air, fire and water, are known as the source of tridhatu or tridosha. Vata, Pitta and Kapha. According to the Vedic tradition, health is the equilibrium of the dhatus, dhatu samya, and disease is the upset of their equilibrium, that is dhatu vaisamya. Charaka and Susruta both support that three inherent dynamic principles, Vata, Pitta and Kapha, are corresponding to the powers of nature, air, sun and moon respectively. In a human body, these three major elements, air, fire and water, are accepted as fundamental constructive principles. According to Susruta, as the sun, moon and air maintain the earth by the action of imparting, taking away and diffusing power, three doshas also maintain the body by analogous actions. Bhagavata second says, dosha samya as health and dosha vaisamya as disease. When these three dhatus remain without proportionate order, then trouble or disorder of body arises. Ayurveda teaches us how to maintain our body required diet, medicines and a regimen of life. According to Charak Samhita, our body is the product of food, and whatever food we are taking daily actually the product of the five elements. Food is regarded as the best sustainer of life. Annagata prana. We have to be cautious in selection of our food and its functions, as it is essential for all living beings. The measurement of food is dependent on one's digestive power, and the intake of this balanced diet in the food hygiene for maintaining the good health. Now, it may be apt here to discuss the functions of three elements essential for hygiene. In the process of digestion, our bodily wind helps to digest the food. Hence, Brahmins used to follow the rule of Pancha Gandusha. During the intake of principal food like rice, etc., with mentioning the name of five vayus, prana, prana, apana, samana, udana, and vyana. Sushruta mentions two sorts of digestion, sweet or heavy, and acrid, that is sour or pungent or light. Five gross elements are divided into these two classes. According to their property, heavy and light. First two gross elements, earth and water, are heavy. But rest three, fire, air and earth, are light. The essence of fat fills the hollow channels of the bones and acted on vayu. Now, water element provides the elixir of life to all living beings. The Yajurveda states, apsu anta amritam apsu bhesajam. It is also related with six rasas, amla, acid, madhu, sweet, tikta, bitter, lavana, saline, katu, pungent, and kashaya, astringent. If all these remains in balanced measurement, then the body represents good health. Bodily digestive fire is most essential in the process of digestion. This fire or tejas substance imparts the essence of rasa as a red pigment, transforming the same into blood. The second dhatu in the order of rasa, rakta, mangsa, med, asti, vajja and sukra. Rasa is ojas. Body is nourished by three important liquids, rasa, rakta and ojas. Lifespan, complexion, strength, health, exertion, growth, luster, ojas, energy, heat and the life breath, etc. are dependent on digestive fire. Charaka tells on the consciousness of good health, which is the fundamental basis of existence of every living being, with the development of four purusharthas, that is dharma, artha, kama and moksha. Dharmartha kama moksha nam arogyam moolam uttamam. Indeed, the wealth of a country depends not only on its natural resources, but also on the vitality and health of its people. For the consciousness of hygiene, we should know our body, diseases and herbal medicines as instructed in Vedic tradition. According to the Charak Samhita, an embryo or a body is a modification of five elements, ether, air, fire, water and earth, and the seat of consciousness. Garbhastu khalu antariksaha vayu agni toya bhumi vikaras chetana adhisthana bhute. According to Mahanaya Prakasa, the five elements remain in our body in five different ways, and all these are related with five elements. The first one is Prithivi Tattva. Tva, Mangsam, Danta, Nakha, Asthini, Iti, Panchagunam, Kathinam, Dehagatam, Prithivi Tattva. That is, the element of earth abides in the body in the solid form with five characteristics, divisions: skin, flesh, teeth, nails and bones. Next comes Jalatattvam. Rasa, Raktam, Kapha, Vasa, Meda, Iti, Panchadha Jalatattvam. That is fluid, blood, flame, marrow and fat. This is the fivefold element of water. Next comes Tejasatattvam. Krodhas, Tatha Mukha Bhav, Mukhagatam, Tejas, Tatha Kayushma, Netragni, Chokshurgatam Prakasakam Tejaha, Jatharagnischa Iti Panchadha Tejas Tattvam. Anger, brightness of the face, warmth of the body, light in the eyes, that is the five element, that is the fire element which abides in the eye and illumines, and digestive fire, Jatharagni, this is the five element of fire. Next, wind, Tatha Pranaha. Prana, Pana, Samana, Udana, Vyanaha, Pancha Vayavaha. Tatcha Panchadha Vayus Tattvam. Pranas, namely the five ways, Prana, Apana, Samana, Udana and Vyana. This is the fivefold element of wind. Next comes Akasha Tattvam. Jathara, Mukha, Shrutra, Hridaya, Nasikagata Akasha, Panchadha Navastattam. The space connected with the stomach, mouth, ear, heart and nostrils in the fivefold element of space. Indeed, the universe consists of five elements. Panchabhuta Mayam Viswam. That is why we have to be more conscious about the purity of these five elements. Through this consciousness, human being can enjoy good health and long life. In the Vedic literature, more than 50 diseases are mentioned. And the seers search the path of nature cure for the remedy of the same. Some of the diseases are, I am mentioning here, opochit, scrofulous swellings, opua, dysentery, ursus, hemorrhoids, allergy, eye disease, arthritica, pain in limbs, asrabo, varia, galunta, swelling, groibia, tumors on the neck, glow, boil, jumbo, convulsions, tokman, fever, dursika, rheum of the eyes, pakaru, ulcers, papayaksma, conjunction, rajayaksma, yaksma, etc. Pristhamaya, that is back pain, pramoto, dominus, balasa, conjunction, biklendu, itara, vidradha, abscesses, bilohita, flow of blood, visuchika, that is also dysentery, iskanda, rheumatism, shirsakti, headache, shirsamaya, disease of the head, and slonia, lameness, svitra, leprosy, surama, wine sickness, hariman, jaundice, hridayamaya or hridyata, heart disease, prudu, cramp, etc. Has very intricate concepts of health, its promotion and preservation. Swastasya swastha rakshanam, aturasya vikara prashamanam. The use of herbal medicines is in practice, and herbs and plants are depicted in the Vedas as anti-disease and vital source of energy. By these herbal medicines, many irremediable diseases could be cured. At the same time, we have to improve our immunity system. Immunity, vadhik shamatva, is a process by which body learns experience of past infection to control subsequent diseases. Now, I would like to mention some herbal plants which are used as medicine. So, Vedic seers were well aware about the healing power in nature and the health protection through Ayurveda. Vedic texts like Rig Veda, Atharva Veda, etc. are some of the earliest available documents detailing the medical knowledge that form the basis of Ayurveda system. Ayurveda apparently means knowledge of life, as our keynote speaker, Professor Mishrajit, told about Ayu, life, more particularly the vigor or healthy growth of consciousness. Ayush Chetana Vrittihi. This health awareness of human wisdom was inbuilt in Vedic seers. They were known about the maintenance of healthy life and the full span of life. Jiveva Saradasatam, Pashema Saradasatam. It is a period from beginning of progeny to the last departure from this world or death. The vegetable world is primarily divided into three categories: Oshadhi, Vanaspati, and Virud. Differences between these three categories are clearly mentioned in Sanskrit literature. Oshadhi means a medicinal plant, or an annual plant or herbs which dies after becoming ripe. Oshadhya phala pakantaha, as Manuspriti says. Sushruta says, phala pakanistha oshadhaya. Jaspa gives the etymology of the term as follows: oshadhaya osad dhayanti tiva asatyena dhayanti tiva doshan dhayanti tiva. It means hearts, oshadhaya, are so called because they suck. Dhayanti, the burning element, oshat, or because people suck them when something is burning in the body, or else they suck the morbid element, that is dosha. So here, three etymologies from the root ush to burn and dhe to suck, in active and passive voice, or from dus and dhe, hints on the medicinal properties of plants. Vanaspati means a large tree that bears fruit apparently without any blossoms. Apuspa phalavanto ye te vanaspataya smrita. Yasko says vanaspati bananang patava palaitava. He is the protector or benefactor of forest. Virud means a spreading creeper. Lata pratanini virud. Virudha oshadhaya bhavanti virahanat. So virud means herbs so called from gathering, from growing. However, all these three categories are different parts of the same to cure the diseases. Medicinal plants, a topic of Ayurveda, were known to the Vedic seers because for achieving the full span of life with sound health and use different parts of herbs, plants, or trees and papers. The Osadhi Sukta of Rigveda gives an account of uses of herbs for good health. Ya Osadhi Purva Jata Devibhya Stri Yugam Pura Manainu Babhrunamaham Satam Dhamani Saptacha. The herbs were produced 3 ages before the gods, which carry off disease, or else there are 700 vital parts of man, the herbs are applied on them. Sapta satan purushasya manmanang esuena dadati tiva. According to Nirukta. Again, virudha paraisnava. Herbs are our means of salvation. And the healing power of herbs are admitted by Vedic seers. Imang me agadam krita. Osadhi prati modadvam puspavati prasubari. Plants may be without flower or having flowers, without fruit or having fruit, are able to cure disease. Ya phalinir ya apala apuspa yascha pushpini brihaspati prasutasta nomunchantvanghasah. The medicinal properties of plants explain the epithet manifold powers, nana birja asadirja. Hundreds of medicinal plants are mentioned in Vedic literature, and in the Athara Veda and in the Osadhi Sukta of Rig Veda, a number of medicinal plants are recorded, like Punannava, Avaka, Jivanti, etc. Still, I would like to mention only few of these plants which are used as medicinal plants. Ajasringi or Aratati. It is used as remedial and extracts foreign body. Eyam agan noshadhinam virudham virjavati ajasringi aratoki tiksnasringi priyasatu. In apa marga, it is also done to us in root, leaves, fruits, seeds, and synonym as pratyakuspi, mayuraka. It is used in the head diseases, anti-inflammatory, hemorrhage, menorrhagia, cough, aphrodisiac, fever in animals, promotes growth of hip, etc. For easy delivery, it is also used. Shudhamaram, Krishnamaram, Agotamana, Apattana, अपामार्गत्वया वयम् वयम् सर्वं तदपमृण्महे अपामार्गो अपमृष्ट क्षेत्रीय सपतश्चय औषधि अपमार्गो अजायथ देन अमला और अमलक धात्री इट इज ऑल्सो फेमस इट इज नॉन टू अस एम्बिलिका ऑफिशियलिस एंड इट इज यूज फॉर बर्डनेस कॉलिंग अप हेयर्स इम्प्रूव एपिटाइट एंड इंटेलेक्ट Orko, this character of his Jayantia, it is also mentioned in Atharvaveda, Ayam Orko Angena Angam Sang Samagam Trinotu. Then Aksa, it is also known to us, and Asvagandha, it is also very famous. Then Kusto, it is Yogirishwa Ajayatha Virudhang Vatlavattama Kustehi Takvanasana Takvanam Nasayantya. Similarly, Modhuk, मंजिष्ठा पाटा पाटा फॉर इजी डिलीवरी एनर्जी पाटा इंद्रो व्यसनाद असुरेभ्य स्तरी तवे एंड मंजिष्ठा इज यूज फॉर फीवर स्पाइडर पॉइजनिंग एंड ऑल्सो यूज एज कॉस्मेटिक सिमिलरली पीपली पीपली इज ऑल्सो नॉन टू मेनी पास प्रोमोट्स वॉइस इम्प्रूव्स एपिटाइट क्योर्स हार्ट डिजीज कफ फीवर हिकअप एटसेट्रा पिप्पली क्षिप्त भेषजी उताती भेषजी तादेव समकल्पयन नित्यम जीवितवा क्लब पिप्पल्य समबदंतायतिर जननादधि वाति कृतस्य भेषजिम अथो क्षिप्तस्य भेषजिम देन पुनर्नवा इट इज ऑल्सो यूज फॉर लॉन्ग लाइफ या रहती पुनर्नवा एंड नंबर ऑफ डाउटफुल स्पेसिस फॉर एग्जैक्ट रिमेडी बट दीज आर मेन्शन एंड मोर देन 165 नेम्स ऑफ प्लांट्स सो वी आर नाउ ऑलमोस्ट एट द एंड इन फाइन इट मे बी सेड that in the context of hygiene, certainly some plant of Vedic texts are used as vegetable drugs and mostly accepted as the base of later Ayurvedic medicines. Since early days, some medicinal plants of Vedic period are used as drug or traditional medicine in practice. It will be a matter of further investigation whether the doubtful or unidentified plants of Vedic Sanhitas are renamed in Ayurveda or other Sanskrit texts. Moreover, the traditional drug and formulations should be investigated into by modern scientific methods to assess their efficacy. Ancient medicinal herbs are descended through generations and are still surviving among the primitive societies or aboriginal tribes living near forest. Due to rapid progress of modern medicines and surgery, herbal medicines are ignored. But it is very interesting to note that recently, in case of pandemic also, people are showing interest in using the herbal medicines for lifelong good health. The concept of hygiene in Vedic tradition is a vast field for further investigation, through which people would be able to eradicate the pandemic and irremediable diseases as well as enjoy long life with good health. Sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pasyantu mapasiddhu bhavatmake. Thank you all for listening my speech with very patience.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We are completely beneficial with your wonderful lecture and this has overwhelmed us and illuminated our eyes of knowledge. Now we are entering our second question answer session. There are some questions in chat box, but only the relevant and selected questions will be answered. We are conveying these to respected Chattopadhyay sir. Firstly, Mr. Ujjal Karmakar asked, Assistant Professor Sanskrit Department of Shalwani Government College, Midnapur, we are advised in the Atharva Veda to cure different diseases by different types of mantras. So yes. How is it possible to cure diseases by the power of mantra?
In those particular mantra, there must an indication of specially name of plants or other hygienic processes, these are mentioned. So mantras are not only for utterance, not only for the utterance, we cannot get the remedy at once. But if we can utter this, the terms inside the mantra would be revealed and the origin of these mantras could take one person to get rid of these diseases. So I think not only utterance of these mantras, first of all we have to understand the mantra, the meaning of this mantra, and the terms are used, because in the Atharva Veda so many terms are used which are still unknown to us. We don't know the exact meaning of that term. So that's why I would like to say, at least go through that particular mantra and find out that for which disease it is mentioned. Then somebody will get the best result.
Okay, thank you sir. The next one is there from the side of Shutapa Chakravarti, there often arises conflicts on the issue of hygiene among the different family members or even among the different members in a society. How to attain social hygiene keeping the referred context in mind? How to arise social hygiene keeping the referred context in mind? Social hygiene keeping the referred concept context in mind.
You please repeat the question. It's not clear to me.
There often arises conflicts on the issue of hygiene among the different family members or even among the different members in a society.
Yes.
How to attain social hygiene keeping the referred context in mind?
This thing I have also mentioned, that in if a particular hygiene is not accepted by all society, suppose a particular hygienic concept is famous in India, but it may not be accepted in America or in other country. And similarly also in the society, and similarly also in the family also. In family also, everybody will not agree with the same thinking. So that's why, but we have to conscious about that particular use, so that or particular practice, then we would be able to get the best result. So there is, we cannot say that in every society or every community will accept a similar concept of hygiene.
Okay, sir. I think it has been understood very well. The third question from Sushmita Niyogi, faculty yes. member from our college. Yes. She asked, how effective can the ancient ways be now where the lifestyles are changing?
Our lives, yes, yes.
Should I repeat, sir?
Yes, yes.
How effective can the ancient ways be yes. now where the lifestyles are changing?
Yes, the lifestyles are changing, there is no doubt. It is the nature of our life, the lifestyle will be changed because you see, I have already seen 6 decades as I reached beyond 60. So I have seen that in before 50 years, people used to defecate in open places. And also, most of the towns or cities, there are use of private service, private, that is in called khata paikhana in Bengali. But these are changed because people don't accept to that wrong hygienic method. But in modern context, especially with the herbal medicine and the medicine and the practices of Vedic seers, which are acceptable, that we can accept. It is not necessary to accept all these previous concepts, but you have to think thrice to finalize before accepting these previous concepts.
Thank you, sir. Excellent. We are really grateful to have you as a resource person for today's webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Arijit. I am very glad to present myself before you. Many thanks to Dr. Nagels.
Thank you, sir. You are welcome. Now we are entering our third and last technical session for today. We can proceed for the last session.
Okay. So this is the time for our third and last technical session for today with the research concept of Kushal Banerjee. Pursuing the MBBS degree from R.G. Kaur Medical College, Kolkata, Dr. Banerjee is studying this currently to pursue MD in pharmacology in medical college. Previously, he worked as an assistant epidemiologist, research scientist too, in the National Institution of Cholera and Enteric Disease. He has working experience as a technical consultant in IMCI Resource Center, NRS Medical College. Presently, he is working as the demonstrator and tutor department of pharmacology, College of Medicine and JNM Hospital, WPUHS. It is interesting to say that during this pandemic situation, he has a lot of emergency duties and responsibilities in the COVID hospital, yet he agreed to deliver a lecture in the hygiene in the time of pandemic for everything the people's consciousness. Sir, I am requesting him to deliver your lecture. We are going to
thank you, ma'am. Am I audible? Hello. Thank you, madam.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You are
audible.
Completely audible.
Thank you, madam.
Excuse me. Islamlal Kaharia, please stop presenting. Islamlal Kaharia. Who is Islamlal Kaharia? Please stop presenting.
Mr. Ishamlal Karharia, please stop yourself from presenting.
Are you here? Ishamlal Karharia, please. I request to the host, please remove Ismailal Karharia.
Yeah, I have removed him. Okay. I had to remove him.
Okay, good evening everybody. Yes, I'd like to offer my sincere thanks to Sir Sharan and sir, the distinguished professor of my professor at the College of Commerce and now the entire college, Vishwanagar. And I would also like to thank the dynamic young educator practicing at Sanskrit for organizing this.
Kushal, sound is not clear yet. Hello? Excuse me, sound is not clear properly.
Sound is not clear, okay. Hello? Hello? Hello, everyone now? Hello?
Yes, yes, yes.
Is it okay
now? No, better.
Is it okay? Okay.
Is it okay?
Okay. Just a second.
Please, enable your video options.
Just. Yeah, video actually network, there is some issues probably, that's why I'm. I was connected, but was it okay then?
Okay, okay, okay. Oh, okay, go ahead, go ahead.
Okay, very good afternoon. I give a good afternoon to everybody. I'd like to offer my sincere thanks to Sri Shokshaja Nemo and the Gossamer Mohammedan College for giving me this opportunity to present the Gossamer Mohammedans.
Professor. Professor, your audio is still not clear.
Hello?
Hello? Hello, Professor Banerjee. Your audio is still not clear.
Hello, is it okay? Hello, is it okay?
Hello? It's better, but
hello?
Not. It's better, but not clear, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Hello, sir.
Hello? Is it okay? Is it okay now?
It's better. It's better now.
I probably need to switch up. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I probably need to switch off the camera because of the network issues here.
Okay, no problem. Now.
Is it okay now?
Yeah, it's perfect. It's perfect now.
Is it clear, the audio?
It's clear. It's clear
okay,
now.
Okay, good. Thank you. Good evening. Okay. So I'd like to proceed without the video because there are some network issues that may be problems if I use the camera. So I'd like to go to the presentation and report that I must thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. The present before us understandings on such a relevant topic. I understand that was it still visible?
Sir, there is some trouble with your audio. Still it's persisting, sir.
Just wait a minute, please. Wait, just 1 second. Is it okay?
Yeah, it sounds better.
Hello?
Yes, sir, it sounds better.
Okay, thank you. Let me try to share my presentation.
Okay, sir, take your time. First, present now, then entire screen, then here.
I think it's fun. I click the option present now.
Yes,
but
sir.
Nothing else is coming.
Present now. Then the entire screen. You will have to select the entire screen.
Present now. I click. Now
there must be showing entire screen.
Nothing. The option present now has.
There must be some options.
No. So even the present now option, I get to cover it.
Then what option you are looking for? After present now.
Turn on captions is there?
Sir, turn on captions is in the left side. Present now is in the right side. You'll have to click on present now button.
Right side, yeah. Present now I clicked, but now there is no option. I clicked that, but there is no, nothing is coming, you know. Let me check one second. Present now is anybody else presenting? It's not there.
Sir, are you getting, are you seeing those options? Select a window, entire screen, etc.
Yeah, no. Even the present now option has become disabled. The present now option that has become seems to be disabled.
Then must be your present option for presentation has been turned off.
Oh, where can I get it? It was there. It was there a few minutes back. When I clicked that, but now I don't.
Somehow, sir. Somehow.
Settings.
Yes, sir. Somehow, when Google Chrome was trying to get your permission, you denied that. That's why now that option is not being shown. Perhaps that may be the reason.
Okay.
Now it's troublesome to turn on that option again. So. Now it would be problematic to.
So can I disconnect or reconnect back or something like that? I didn't get an option to share the screen or something.
I think that option has been disabled somehow, mistakenly.
So
that has been disabled. I think I am afraid that you have to continue without those presentations, without those PPTs. I am afraid.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Okay.
Hello.
Because
been disabled somehow. There were those options and.
Hello. Hello.
You are audible, sir. You are audible.
Okay. So. Okay, but without the presentation, it will not go well anyway. Let me mess up with that if the option is not there. Okay, should I map anything, madam? I mean, close the caption
that. Sir, sound is not clear yet properly. I think you have to change the headphone yet.
No, not sir, not here, sir.
I only want to. Okay, I can hear you.
There is some problem with your mouth.
Just a minute.
Sir, can you please change your headphone or something?
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I have only one headphone, so I am afraid that if it.
Initially it seems okay, but when you are continuing for 1 or 2 minutes, then it's becoming very tough to get to you.
Now can you get me, let me try once again, with the mouthpiece, and present to my, is it better right now?
Is it better?
Can I add it in now?
No, not clearly, sir.
Same thing.
Sir, can you please try without the headphone?
Then how, will you hear me? Without the headphone, can you hear me?
I think in laptops there are inbuilt microphones. There would be no problem without headphones. I am speaking without headphones.
Okay, let me try removing the headphones.
Sir, after plugging off the headphone, you will have to leave the meeting, then you will have to rejoin. Otherwise, the sound system would not work.
Hello.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir, and you are visible too. You are visible and you are audible.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir, you are audible and you are visible. We can see you.
Okay. Thank you. Now let me wait. Hello, yeah.
I'm yes.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Okay. But there is no option. Okay, there is no option to present yet.
Okay, I think there is some issues with your network. Network is weak somehow. That's why this problem is
there.
Okay.
Net, yeah, maybe. Let me check for 1 minute when the option comes.
Okay, sir.
Present. And I'd like to show some things which are not to people that the descriptions from that India. That would help others. Now some options are there for the camera, but not for the presentation yet.
Presentation.
Hello.
Hello, sir. Hello. 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 Sir, can you hear me, sir? Can you hear me, Professor Banerjee? Professor Banerjee, can you hear me? I think we have lost the connection. So, we'll have to wait for a few minutes. I think there are some serious technical glitches with Professor Banerjee. That's why there is some issues in his connection in Google Meet. We'll have to wait for a few minutes and we'll see whether he can join again. Dr. Abhijit Gupta, can you please contact Professor Banerjee and see whether he can join again?
Yes, I have contacted with him. He is trying to join again.
Okay, okay. Then it's better we wait a few minutes.
Okay, okay. He is trying for other device, I think.
Okay, okay. Thank you, participants, for your patience. We'll wait for a few minutes for Professor Banerjee. I hope he will be joining again and there will be no technical glitches. Professor Banerjee has joined again.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir. Please unmute yourself, sir. Professor Banerjee, please unmute yourself from your new device. Kindly unmute yourself, sir. Professor Banerjee, am I audible? Can you hear me, sir? Kindly unmute yourself, sir. Sir, kindly unmute yourself, sir, from your new device.
Sir, click on the button showing left below. Hello? Dr. Banerjee?
Dr. Banerjee, just touch your screen and at the bottom of your screen, there is a icon of a microphone. You'll have to touch that button.
Now is it okay, probably?
Sir. Yes, sir. It's perfect.
Okay, I'm very sorry for the disruption because of the network issues or something like that.
Yes, sir. We have to deal with glitches in our online platforms. So these are part of it. So no problem, sir. You can continue.
Okay. My purpose for this program is mainly to for general awareness purposes, and it's not for telemedicine, so I don't think that it will be considered as a kind of medical consultation or something like that, but just for general awareness. What I realized in recent times is that very commonly so many information are flooding up in WhatsApp, Facebook and elsewhere regarding health issues, what to do and what not to do. Many of them are not so authentic. Some are definitely authentic, but many of them are created by wonderful minds, which may be good literary works, but not scientific. So I would like to present certain scientific facts before you, but it would be better if we could use the presentation. Anyway, there is a famous saying, cleanliness is next to godliness. You know that very commonly people associated with Mahatma Gandhi, but probably before Mahatma Gandhi, there was an English preacher. He was named John Wesley, and he was the main person who probably promoted the concept of cleanliness is next to godliness. Some people find it reference to Bible also, but anyway, the origin doesn't matter so much. It influenced Mahatma Gandhi to propagate the theory of cleanliness is next to godliness. What does hygiene actually refer to? We have already heard eminent speakers speaking on this topic. Hygiene basically it relates to cleanliness. So what? So cleanliness? Cleanliness because it can improve cleanliness and it helps to maintain health. And of course, it helps thereby to prevent the spread of diseases. So right now at this moment, ye to bahut zaruri hai ki we keep the disease at bay and we stay healthy. So that's why this topic becomes very much relevant in today's time. And there are a lot of diseases that can occur because of poor hygiene. We know about the diarrheal diseases. Diarrheal diseases are very common in our country and in other developing countries. A large part of the diarrheal diseases are because of poor hygiene. There are other factors also. We shall come to that, poor sanitation and water issues and something like that. So hygiene is basically, as we discussed, it is mainly an issue that deals with cleanliness, but it's an active part that has to be played by all of us. So it is not something that the government can only do, it's not something that other people can do. It is somewhere we individuals need to play some active role. It's an active process. So apart from diarrhea, there are so many fungal infections, there are respiratory infections. Right now, in the time of COVID pandemic, it has become more important. But apart from COVID, there are so many diseases that can be transmitted through similar routes. And in India, tuberculosis is very much important, and there are respiratory infections, especially in children, respiratory infections and diarrhea, they are leading causes of mortality also. A lot of children die because of these diseases. And research has found that if we can promote good hygiene, around 40% of diarrhea diseases can be controlled, as well as a good amount of respiratory diseases also can be checked in. And this is before COVID pandemic. And it gets much more importance at the time of COVID pandemic. Now, there are other diseases like lice and scabies. These are infections that can occur if we do not get good hygiene. So, lice, for lice, we all know that there are small insects which come to our body. And there may be many people from the history background. History is a very interesting subject anyway. A lot of history deals with war. So, starting from the Mahabharata war and so many other wars also. So we have fought so many wars, civilizations after civilizations, and a lot of lives have been lost in this exercise. But why? Because there were so many reasons, but one important reason for all the wars was that my land, this is my land, and I will not allow anybody else to stay in my land. So you do not want anybody to stay in your land, but you want ugly creatures, small insects and something, to stay not on your land, not in your home, but on your own body. So this is very common in our country. Scabies is a common infection that is also due to a small creature. So they also come and they make our body their home. They reproduce there inside the body, they make tunnels. Very recently, we were very much concerned about the foreign troops coming to our territory, and our brave soldiers, many of them sacrificed their lives to defend the territory. So defense is important for any country, and similarly for individuals, we need to have a defense mechanism against the invaders. The invaders in the body may be microorganisms, bacteria, viruses, something like that, and maybe little bit larger creatures, and we can avoid many of them if we just follow good hygiene. And I always stress on this point that hygiene is an active process, so individually we have to work on that. It is not that someone else is going to do it for us. We cannot blame the government, you cannot blame anybody, you have to do it on your own. So there are so many aspects of hygiene. One important thing is hand washing and nail hygiene. We shall stress on this issue a large bit. Apart from hand washing and nail hygiene, it's a healthy child care, because children, small children, they cannot take care of themselves. So it is the responsibility of the adults in the family who can take care of the child or children so that they remain clean and the hygiene are properly maintained in children. There is another part called body, facial and dental hygiene. Dental hygiene includes regularly brushing your teeth, preferably after each meal or at least after breakfast or after dinner. And body hygiene means regularly bathing with soap and water, staying clean and so on. Hand washing, I shall come into detail on that. We also have a new concept called swimming hygiene, because in swimming pools, and those who use swimming pools, they share a common pool. And not just you are going to the water, your sweat is also mixing with the water. Not just sweat, and there are other body secretions, even urine can also get in. And it's not Indian perspective. I'm taking data from the United States, none other than the CDC Atlanta, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, which is the leading agency in the United States to guide their policies as well in the global policies on health and something. So the CDC, they say in their website that in swimming pools, it can, the water can get contaminated with urine and even feces. So that can be a big problem in swimming pool. So to take care of those things are included in swimming hygiene. We also have other concepts like house hygiene, to keep the house clean so that diseases do not come in. Pet hygiene, those who have pet cats or pet dogs at home, they need to take care of those pet animals, because if those animals, they cannot take care of them in a good way, or cats do sometimes, we have seen that cats licking their body to keep clean, but still they cannot do it in so good way, and there are other issues involved with the pet fur or the pet dander. They also can get dandruff like us in a different way. So all these things can create problem for the pets as well as for the household where the pet has been kept. So it is also important concept to take into account of the pet hygiene. There is another important issue to keep your food protected from contamination. It is not, we shall come to some part in hand washing, but in addition to that, hand washing, we need to take care of other issues like keeping a lid on the food, which is cooked, or refrigerating it properly. Refrigeration, you know, there is a temperature below 5 degrees, it kind of reactivates the pathogenic organism, most of them. And when we cook the food at high temperature, it kills most of the organisms. Now I have a question. It's an online session, so probably answers will not be so easy, but still, it may be probably posted in the chat box. I would like to audience to think, just an imagination, an idea. One single gram of stool, okay, one single gram of stool that weighs just the same as a paper clip. You have seen the James clip we attach to the papers. A single paper clip weighs 1 gram. So if we take the weight of the paper clip, the similar weight of a stool, human stool, how many germs it may contain? Any idea? Just a guess, 100, 1000, 2000, 10,000. I would like to encourage the audience to post in the chat box. You can have an idea how far we can go close to the estimate, the scientific estimate. The scientific estimate says 1 trillion. 1 trillion germs can be there in single gram of food. 1 single gram of food. So if we do not clean our hands with soap and water properly after toilet, even a small amount of stool, if it hides somewhere even beneath the nail bed or something, that can contain a very, very large amount of germs which can be transmitted to food. Or if you touch your face, nose somewhere, many a times people touch their eyes, nose, mouth, even without recognizing those things, just in a subconscious way, something like that. But if there is small amount of germs staying in the hand, that can be transmitted to that person. For example, if you are cooking some food, or if you are touching some door handle and some other person comes and touches the same door handle, so the germ can transmit from your hand to the door handle and from the door handle to that person's hand. And now again, if that person doesn't wash the hand and touches his or her mouth, nose, finger, eyes, so that person can also get contaminated. It has been thought of even before COVID, but now in the COVID pandemic, it has become much more relevant. One thing is that COVID is teaching us some lessons. It is definitely a big challenge to us. Suddenly, we have been thrown to a war with very little ammunition. We don't know the enemy well, and we hardly have any weapon to kill the enemy, but still, we can battle the, definitely we can battle it with all our strength. In that case, we shall learn some habits that can help to improve our hygiene, and in later on, after the pandemic, if we can continue practicing some habits like hand washing, sanitization and so on, it will help us to get rid of many other diseases as well, which may be as dangerous or more dangerous than COVID, at least in the developing countries like us. So I didn't think that many people had gives the amount of germs in the stool, not much post-finger loop. Anyway, so what COVID teaches us, that don't touch your nose, your mouth, your eyes before cleaning your hands. But there are a procedure of washing your hands. There are 6 steps involved. Unfortunately, I couldn't show you the video, but still you can find it on YouTube. On CDC's channel. CDC is the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, or you can search WHO, World Health Organization. They are promoting good educational materials for general people. There are 6 steps of hand washing that needs to be taken care of. First, you need to open the tap, you have to wet your hands, then take the soaps, cleanse thoroughly, in between the fingers, in the nails, near the thumb, base of the thumb, in the wrist, there are and at least 20 seconds time have to be spent so that effective killing of COVID is possible. The virus SARS-CoV-2, that is possible. It will take around 20 seconds. Sanitizers are now very popular nowadays, but there are certain important things to be kept in mind. Sanitizers are not as good as hand washing. You can use sanitizers only when hand washing is not possible. You don't have soap or water adequately to wash your hands, then you can use sanitizers. But so many companies are now launching sanitizers. It is good that in our country, we people say that India can do jugaad. So jugaad ho jata hai har kisi ne, acha hai ki hum log bana sakte hain. So very very short time, so many companies have come with sanitizers. But one thing is, you need to check whether the sanitizer contains adequate amount of ethyl alcohol or isopropyl alcohol. There are different agencies like CDC, the WHO, United States, FDA. FDA is their regulatory agency, Food and Drug Administration. FDA regulates new drugs and other food-related products in the United States. So there are different, little bit difference of opinions are there. At least 60% alcohol must be there. But in the context of COVID pandemic, they are saying at least 70% alcohol. If it is ethyl alcohol, you need to check the level of the container. It has to be at least 60 to 70% is preferred. Some are saying 80% but at least 70% ethyl alcohol is preferred. If it is isopropyl alcohol, it has to be 75%. So when to wash our hands or sanitizations, and more than sanitization, I would recommend washing your hands before and after you prepare a food. And before cooking, after cooking, or any non-cooked food also, that is more important if the food is not cooked, like roti, chapati, or whatever. So, and if you are caring for a sick person, if there is someone in your home or somewhere who is sick, so whenever you are going to touch the person, before touching that person, you need to wash your hands thoroughly, because your hands may be carrying germs to that person who is already sick, and the immunity in that person may be a little bit compromised. So if you transmit additional germs to that person, that can be more risky for him or her. On the other hand, you can also get your hands contaminated by treating that person. So after treating a sick person, you also need to wash your hands thoroughly. If you have a wound, an injury in your body, and then also before touching the wound, you need to wash your hands thoroughly, because again, your hands can be contaminated and that can transmit bacteria to the wounds. And similarly, after touching the wound, if you are dressing or something, you are applying some medicine there, and after that, you need to wash your hands once again. Because if the wound is somehow infected, you cannot see the germs with your eyes only, without the help of microscopes and something. So if there are germs in the wound, then that germs can again contaminate your fingers, which can later be transmitted to other persons, or to your, it can come to your body. Even for COVID pandemic, it is said that if it comes, the germ can come to your hand by touching the door handle, the stairs. We have the rail in the stairs. If you, or you are going to public place, you are holding the handle in a bus or other public vehicle, so your hands can get contaminated. But if you wash your hands, or in the outside, if you don't have the facility to wash, you use sanitizers properly, then you can kill the germ there. It can, but if you do not wash, do not sanitize your hand and you touch your nose, mouth and thing or face, it can get inside your body. But directly through the skin, it is not usually expected to come inside the body until and unless you invite it. So before it can get access to your nose, your eyes or your mouth, you need to kill it in your hand if it, your hand is contaminated. Some more important issues are there. This is not just for COVID, for other diseases also, diarrheal diseases and other illnesses also. Washing hand after toilet is a must. But unfortunately, in our country, there are a lot of people who do not have the habit. I understand that there are people who do not have the facilities of clean access to water. That is a separate issue. But in addition to inaccessibility to clean water, there are many people who do not have this habit. As a hygiene is about habit. So there are many people in our country still who do not wash their hands after going to toilets. So this is something dangerous and that helps to in spreading of the different kinds of organisms. Not just COVID, there are so many other organisms that can, diseases and organisms that can spread through that way. For if you are handling a child and you are changing the diaper, maybe the child or even for adults also, after changing the diaper, one needs to clean the hands with soap and water. And same thing for cleaning a child, the child going to toilet and after coming from the toilet, the mother or someone else in the family is taking care of the child, cleaning the child. So even after that cleaning of the child, the hand needs to be thoroughly washed. Many people do not consider that child to be infectious, especially the stool of the child. But for nature, it is just stool. You cannot distinguish between the stool of a child. It is not different from the adult stool. So that can also contain the trillions and trillions of germs. So after handling a child who has come out of toilet, if you are killing the child, you also need to wash your hands thoroughly. Many people, I just told that many people who have domestic animals at home, maybe cat, dog, or maybe in rural areas, people also have cows or goats in their home. So if you are handling animals, or if you are giving food to the animal, or even after you are removing the animal excreta, or it may so be that you are giving some food to the dog or cat and it has not taken the entire food, some amount of food is left. Now you are taking care of the, you are throwing or something, that extra food. So if you are handling that food, you have to wash your hands, because that can contain a lot of germs and which can produce diseases. For after killing garbage, of course, and very, very important at this moment at least, that is whenever you are touching common objects, door handles, which are very commonly infected, because a lot of people touch the same door handle to open it or to close it. So door handles are very contaminated, very potential source of infection. In addition to door handles, there are even tables. In office workplace, you will get the tables, chairs, and other things which are used by more than one person, and so they can get contaminated. There is one way to wash your hands, and there are other issues also, how to disinfect them. We shall come to them as time permits. Okay, hand wash sanitizers, I told already that there are differences, but do check if it contains at least 70% of ethyl alcohol or 75% isopropyl alcohol. There is something very important. It came to light even before COVID pandemic. You know, even long before, when we just passed MBBS, we heard something. Some people went to Japan and they said that people in Japan, when someone is having cough or someone is sneezing, that person uses mask. There was no COVID pandemic at that time, but people, just to prevent the germ from transmitting the disease to the healthy person, people had that kind of knowledge, the responsibility, that they use masks. And that's why Japan is there. I mean, after two nuclear weapons also, I mean, after two atomic bombs, Japan is in the top. So that is something that they have, the Japanese people have in them. So that is the culture, that is the etiquette that also we need to learn. In our practice, if we want our country to prosper, it is not always blaming others of the government or this party, that party, whatever. It's not everything that will be taken care of by others. Something we have to do on our own. So what about coughing and sneezing? Many people, very commonly we have seen that people cough without covering their mouth. Even in the, before the COVID, when we were sitting in the OPDs in the hospital, we found many people. Most of the people that would, they would come and they would not cover their mouth and they would cough openly. So this is something that helps in spreading the germ to other people around. So in COVID, it is being repeatedly highlighted that the mouth and nose must be properly covered before coughing or sneezing. How to cover it? It is recommended to use disposable tissue papers and to dispose it properly. It is very important. It has not to be dropped anywhere. It has to be dropped in a closed lid container in a proper way, because that tissue may contain infection. The problem with our society is that we do not think, so long we are not very sick, we do not think that we are infected. But at least in this pandemic, it has shown that most of the people will remain asymptomatic. They will not have any symptom. That means, like, it may be so that I am talking to you, I may have the infection inside me. So in that case, I can be infectious to you or anybody who is feeling that, okay, I'm healthy, I don't have any problem, that person may be also carrying the virus, and the virus can transmit from that person to anyone else. Therefore, these etiquettes need to be taken care of by anybody. So these disposable tissues are recommended, and one thing was said by WHO, even before the COVID pandemic, that if you do not have a tissue, if you don't have a handkerchief, don't cough on your hand. If you have to cover your mouth, cough on your elbow. You can cover with your elbow, not on your hand, because if you cough on your hand, you will touch with your hand some other surfaces. But if you cough on your elbow, it is much less likely that the elbow will be contaminating the door handle or the electric switches or maybe the table or something which other people can also use. So it is very important, the cough etiquette, which is unfortunately very bad in our country. We have seen in the outpatient department and the outdoors of the hospital, people with multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Remember, multi-drug resistant tuberculosis is a big threat in our country, and this is something that we don't have any drug to treat it. And tuberculosis, which it cannot be treated with any drug, can really be very, very dangerous. So those patients also do not have that etiquette to cover their mouth, so that can really be dangerous. So in our country, cough etiquette needs to be taken care of very seriously. And one special thing about today's program here is that I think that it can have a bigger impact other than just ordinary webinars. Here we have a lot of teachers, and there is a famous saying, it was said that a teacher, he cannot say where the his or her impact will last. The teacher just lit up a fire, and that goes on motivating and enlightening generations after generations, directly and indirectly. So as there are many teachers here, I believe that it can be much more effective if we can, all of us, if we can together take it seriously to motivate everybody in and around us, so that we make people habituated with cough etiquette, with hand washing, and all these good techniques that we are discussing today. But one important thing, just cough etiquette, we told that you have to cover your mouth and nose with tissue and something, and have to dispose that tissue in a closed container properly. But what to do after that? Even after that, your hand may be contaminated. Because when someone sneezes or cough, a lot of pathogenic germs can spread in and around that can contaminate your hand also. And after handling the tissue, again you need to wash your hands thoroughly. So hand sanitization, the hand hygiene, is of utmost importance in different areas. As we discussed a little bit earlier, that the access to water may be a problem. We are telling people to wash your hands thoroughly for 20 seconds, ideally for 2 minutes. And so many things are there that people are advised that you should wash your hands thoroughly with soap and water and so on. But what about the places where people do not have access to water? That's a big issue in many parts of the world. in our country as well as in many parts of the Africa, there are people who do not have access to clean drinking water. So for them, using water for washing hands is more than a luxury. But thankfully, the governments across the planet and leading organizations like the World Health Organization, the UNICEF is the United Nations Children's Fund. Earlier it was called United Nations Children's Emergency Fund, but later on with the United Nations Children's Fund. So these organizations, international organizations, are trying their level best with the governments of different countries to ensure that people get adequate supply of water, sanitation, as well as hygiene. There is a strategy called WASH strategy. If you are interested, you can search on the internet. I couldn't show you the slides, unfortunately. The WASH, W-A-S-H, it stands for water, sanitation, and hygiene. There are certain things that we need to keep in mind. We talked about hand washing, we talked about cough etiquette, we talked about other issues, but there is an important thing to disinfect our working places. Thankfully, probably the schools and colleges are still closed, so the chances of students or other faculties getting contaminated is comparatively less, but still many offices are already open. For us, hospitals are always open. So there is an important issue that we need to keep in mind, that any person coming to the office or workplace, that person may be symptomatic, may be asymptomatic, and that person can contaminate, can transmit that organism to others. So we need to take care of not just for washing hands, definitely that has to be done at individual level. We also need to take care of disinfection of the area. Commonly we have seen nowadays people doing spraying here and there in many places. Yes, these are required. But there are some simple things for general hygiene, be it for COVID, be it for something else. For COVID it is more relevant, but apart from COVID also, there are issues we need to take care of, like simple things, the very simple things, like the common areas, like door knobs, maybe the handrails, handles, toilets, the faucets, the sink, and all these things. These are very commonly used by so many people. And so as more than one person is using something, that means there is a chance for infection to transmit from one person to another. So these areas have to be routinely cleaned. How? Common soap water that can be used first, followed by disinfectant at the COVID time. There are other things also, like hypochlorite, sodium hypochlorite. Sodium hypochlorite, remember, this is never to be used on human body. It can be used only to disinfect the surfaces, inanimate objects, surfaces like door handles, maybe the floors or the hand railings or something like that. So sodium hypochlorite can also be prepared for domestic bleaching powder that we commonly use. There are techniques. Those who are interested, they can search on the internet. But do search for the reliable sources like WHO, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, or these reliable sources who can provide. Their detailed guidelines are available how to prepare hypochlorite solution from domestic bleaching powder. There are other things, mobile phones. Our mobile phones, yes, this is a very highest source of infection. So what to do with the mobile? It was said that you can clean the mobiles with alcohol tissue swab. But what happened in my personal case, I can tell you one example. After coming from the hospital, especially in fever clinics where we see a lot of COVID patients, I used to clean my mobile phone with cotton and soap in alcohol. What happened, my mobile is now drunk. It now behaves in a way that it can no longer be handled. So I have to keep that away. And now WhatsApp I have transmitted to this tab, and mobile I'm using a basic ordinary phone, which I can put in a plastic container. The plastic container, that can be sterilized, that can be cleaned with alcohol, and the phone can be taken out of that. So that's an alternative that I had to devise out of it. So there are other things also. Very importantly, I would like to stress on the rails of the stairs. For the elderly people, they cannot climb stairs or get down st- downstairs without touching the handles, the handrails. But the problem is when they are touching the handles, that might have been touched by other people. So they can get the virus in their hands. And in addition to that, the elderly people are more vulnerable to COVID. So we need to be very cautious. To in workplaces, we can sanitize the handrails properly, and we need to sensitize every person, the elderly people in our home, and not just elderly, everybody, to cleanse our hand properly after you have touched any common object, be it door handle, be it stairs, anything. Even for commonly used switches, electrical switches and something, you can use alcohol swabs to disinfect them. One important thing I have noticed in hospitals also, that those who are doing this cleaning stuff, unfortunately, they are not properly, they do not that much careful. So we need to arrange for more and more trainings, and we need to monitor them properly, because in many places they are not protected themselves well. People think that, okay, I'm training with some disinfectant, so I can do well. But it is recommended, strongly recommended, that whoever is cleaning these public objects, that person must wear disposable gloves. And even after rinsing, the gloves should be discarded properly. It's very important we do not throw anything in the open. It has to be properly discarded. And after discarding the gloves, one should wash hands again with soap and water. So, one thing is that many people are nowadays saying that soap is damaging the skin. Yes, it is doing something, but this is something unnecessary. This is something unnecessary evil that we have to tolerate. Sanitizer is a little bit less damaging to the skin to some extent, but definitely hand washing is a better option in many cases. There are proper guidelines to wash different surfaces. So the housekeeping staff in our working areas need to be properly trained how they should clean. And whenever there is a risk of splashing, people must wear masks and preferably eye protection. Eye protection is important for others also. Whenever we are coming in contact with anybody who is coughing or something, so there will be a lot of germs that will spread to the air. It is called aerosol. Small aerosols can travel a long distance. So if we are having our mask, if the person who is infected is having mask, that is the best way first, because that prevents the aerosols from escaping outside. Second, the other persons in close proximity, they should also wear masks. And the eyes need to be protected in certain cases, because the eyes are also vulnerable sources. So if the aerosols come in contact with the eyes, they can transmit the disease to eyes also. So eye protection, even a spectacles, is better than nothing. And one important thing for, so at this moment we are using a lot of disinfectants, sodium hypochlorite, bleaching powder, other chemicals also, which are really dangerous for the human body. So we need to ensure that these things are stored properly in a sealed way and properly labeled, so that accidentally other people, especially children, do not get exposed to those toxic chemicals. One important thing I must highlight, that is the mask. Unfortunately, people can say that why India is having 20 lakh COVID cases. So big reason, if you go to the streets, many of you might have seen that most of the people are not wearing, a large number of people at least, they are not wearing the mask properly. People do not realize how dangerous it is. I asked many people, I have seen many people, domestic, even yesterday, actually the day before yesterday, I ordered something online, and this e-commerce agent who came to deliver, in fact I ordered sanitizers, though the person who came to deliver the sanitizers were not wearing the mask, and he didn't have gloves on his hands. So common argument for these people is that, in Bengali they say gorom gaj. So yes, India is a hot country, we will feel not feel comfortable wearing a mask, But a simple surgical mask will not give you that much discomfort. What we usually get when we wear N95 masks in while handling COVID patients. And not just N95 masks, a doctor, a nurse, or other healthcare worker, or other people posted there, they need to wear a full set of personal protective equipment. You have seen them, they look like space suits and something like that. But they are very difficult to handle, and we have to spend hours in that dresses. So that is not very comfortable. Rather, very much uncomfortable. So we can bear with that, we have to bear with that for personal protection and for protection of others. So in that sense, this responsibility comes to each one of us to ensure that we are wearing at least the surgical mask properly. Our nose, many people just put the mask in a way that the nose is coming out. No use. If the mask, if a nose is coming out with the air, with our breath, a good amount of virus can come out and that can contaminate us. And also, if the virus is spreading through the aerosol of someone else's breath or through other means, that can directly go to my nose or I can inhale those aerosols and the person can become sick. So the most important way, definitely, it has to be done that everyone covers his or her nose as well as mouth properly with at least a surgical mask. N95 or FFP2 masks are definitely better, but this may not be available or may not be required in that seriously everywhere. But at least a surgical mask, a paper, even the cloth mask people are saying, but scientifically this cloth mask do not offer that much protection. Again, something is better than nothing. That can help in prevention of spreading the aerosol, but at least a surgical mask, three-layer surgical mask, that has to be worn at any public place. Unfortunately, I have seen many young people, there are students, lot of students here, so I think please do take note of it for yourselves and for your friends and everywhere. Commonly, we have a feeling that when we are talking to people known to us, we open the mask. The virus doesn't know you, the virus doesn't know your friend. Both of the person who are talking to each other may be known to each other, but the virus doesn't know each one of them. The virus is not a friend of anyone. So it can definitely be transmitted from one person to another. So even if you are talking to your very close friends, you should wear your mask properly with your nose and mouth covered. And you should also ensure, this is also important, that your friend also wears a mask in a similar way. When we are going to markets, people are, the vegetable vendors or other people, they are selling their product without wearing mask. With the same excuse, they are feeling hot, they are not feeling comfortable. So it is not a good time. We are not having a party time here right now. We are having a pandemic. We are at a war. When we are at war, it is not time to party. It is not time to relax. So we need to bear with certain problems. We shall have little discomfort with the masks, but we have to do that. It's already 20 lakhs. If we do not want it to go on and on like this, what can prevent at maximum impact can be done with if people wear masks properly. So not just we must wear masks and we must ensure we must pose that the other person in our close contact within 6 feet at least, they should wear a triple layer surgical mask as well. One more important thing, so many masks are flooding in the market on online sites and something. Actually, let me share you a simple personal experience. I wanted to buy masks for myself. We need N95 masks in the hospital, so it's a dangerous area, so we need to wear N95 masks. I was searching for N95 masks. An equivalent level is called FFP2. So I was trying to find a lot in big search engines, and most of the things I found were of doubtful quality, of course. So anyway, so with so many masks around the market, we need to take care of at least one thing. Whether N95 or FFP2, that's secondary issue, even a surgical mask can do, but don't use masks that are having a respirator valve. At least if it is not coming from a good company. or from any company, if it comes, the masks which have a bulb attached, you can see a bulb on right side or on the left side. There is a bulb attached to the mask. These bulbs can allow the air to escape. It filters the air that is coming in, but it doesn't filter the air that is going out. So if the person is infected, that person can exhale virus with the breath, and those viruses can definitely freely go out through the bulb and can infect others. So government has also issued notification recently preventing the use of these masks. So do not use masks which are having bulbs. Another important issue in this context, it is not there in the regulations or in the scientific literature yet. This has came to my mind that so many companies are manufacturing masks. We do not know their quality. Not all companies are certified. There are certification agencies who certify whether the mask is good or not. But people are buying those masks. But imagine one thing, if the bulb is supposed to allow air out, it should not allow the air to go in. But if the bulb is somehow defective, and if it allows the air in, so what will happen? You can also get infected through the same mask. So masks with bulbs are not preferred now. Masks without bulbs are now more preferred as per the current evidences available with us. It is dangerous in the other sense. People often open the mask whenever they are using a mask. They open the mask whenever they are trying to talking to other people. Right now I am talking because there is no one in this room, but if there is some other people, many people are there, they just open the mask when they are trying to talk. They give an excuse that it will not be heard properly. It can be heard. If you speak a little bit louder, it can be heard. You speak, even when I am using N95 mask, it can be heard. Other people, even the patients, the other healthcare workers, the other doctors and nurses, they can hear. So your voice can be heard. It is not that the mask will mask your sound also, but the mask must not be open while talking, because when talking, there is more risk of virus going out. When we are just staying quiet, the virus can go out through the breath. But when we are talking, it can also come out through our mouth. So it is more dangerous. So we need to be more careful that we should take care of our masks. And that is essential. We cannot think of anything about the mask right now. It can be something like, the persons who are moving around without masks are doing a very big harm to the country. And unfortunately, this is something that they do not realize, unfortunately, but this is something very, very, very dangerous. And one thing I must highlight, nowadays, it is seen that some people, they are dropping their masks or used gloves anywhere. That is extremely dangerous. Dropping a used mask is like dropping a bomb. So you are doing a very grave offense to the society if you are dropping a used mask anywhere. Because that mask can be contaminated and that can help spreading the diseases. Not just for SARS-CoV-2, there will be other infection organisms which can spread. So it is very important not to dispose any used item, masks or gloves, anything here and there. These things have to be properly disposed. So it should not be discarded anywhere. Please do not do it, and do not encourage others not to do it, so that nobody drops a mask or gloves anywhere. That's to be properly discarded. Another thing, please. I apologize, please do not take it in a wrong way. Do not take it in any religious or political issue. Something I am quoting based on the core science, but I found on the internet from reliable sources that I find from none but the CDC, Center for Disease Control, Atlanta, and there are other agencies also who are strongly advocating that if you have a bear, that can strongly impair with your mask, especially if you are in a high-risk area. In a high-risk area, you need an N95 mask that will properly seal everything. from your nose to mouth, everything needs to be properly sealed. If you have a beard, not a small one, that can go inside the mask. If there is a beard that is hampering the proper fitting of the mask, so there will be passages for the virus to go in or go out to that area if there is not proper sealing of the mask with the face. N95 masks or such masks have a nose clip also. After wearing the mask, it is recommended that you use the nose clip so that it gives a better seal with your face and it will cover the mouth and the nose properly so that it doesn't, the exhaled air doesn't go out and the inhaled air doesn't go in, come in without filtration. So I hope I have taken a lot of time. Unfortunately, I couldn't show you the presentation. Anyway, thank you very, very much for bearing with me for this longer time. And if you need to apply any of these things, I would like to strongly encourage everyone, go to the websites of CDC, WHO, you will find a lot of information that can definitely be useful. Do not always believe what you get in social media and Facebook or WhatsApp. It may be true, may not be true. So do verify information. There are some dangerous information also moving around in social media. Be careful about them. There are authentic sources. Our government is there also. There are international agencies who are providing genuine information as per available science, as per available evidence. Remember, evidence can change because the disease is new. There are new scientific evidences are coming, but still up-to-date information are updated in their website. So please do visit those websites and let us have a good, healthy time ahead. I wish all of you a good health in the coming days. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for delivering a lecture with such a relevant topic in a wonderful way of presentation. I think participants are also benefited with this lecture. Chat box shows that. Thank you. Now we are entering the last question answer session. For sake of time, only some relevant questions from the chat box will be answered. We convey those to the speaker. Can we go ahead, sir?
Yes.
Okay, let me see the chat box. There is a question from Subir Kumar Singh. He asked, is the immune system very important to fight against virus?
Pardon?
Is the immune system very important to fight against virus?
Definitely, definitely. Actually, not just for COVID, actually, we all of us now know the term coronavirus. Coronavirus, this is only one type of coronavirus. There are other coronaviruses which have been with us earlier. You know another epidemic that had occurred in China earlier, but even apart from such organisms, we also get other illness like even for common cold. That one of the organisms for causing common cold is a coronavirus. That is not this coronavirus, but that is a different type of virus. So there are so many organisms which are moving around us, not just viruses, other organisms are also there, and our immunity is depending against that. As I told in the beginning that defense is important. One is hygiene and the other definitely is the immunity, and strengthening our immunity is also necessary. Good nutrition, good actually, you know, there are conditions in our science which are nowadays actually which came to limelight after we have HIV/AIDS. What HIV/AIDS does, it cripples the immunity, and there are so many diseases which occur in HIV positive patients who are in advanced stage. Nowadays we have drugs which we can arrest the progression of HIV, but those who have advanced AIDS, in those persons there are certain diseases, certain infections which can become very dangerous in those persons but not in others because their immunity is compromised. So these infections, which are called opportunistic infections, they, when they get an opportunity means when your defense is weak. So in that case, just like if our army or other forces are weak, the enemy can come in. Similarly, the viruses or other organisms can come in. They do attack us. We are already in continuous attack by different enemies, but our immune system keeps us healthy. So it is definitely of extreme importance. And for viral diseases, we have seen that most of the people are getting well even after COVID. So that is, most of them are protected from the infection, and those who are, most of them who are getting COVID are getting well, because the immune system can take care of the virus. So definitely immunity is our strongest friend in this thing.
Okay, sir. And another question from Prashant Chatterjee. Can we affect our liver by COVID-19?
Actually, new evidences are coming in different ways. It is not yet clear that which organs can be damaged and which organs cannot. New evidences are coming because the disease is new. Recently, we heard about a report. I'm not yet very, it's from KEN, KEN Mumbai, but I thought that I should verify it from my friends in KEN Mumbai, but I have not been able to do that. The news came that many people who were actually cured of COVID, they became negative. Later on, some, not very few, just a few people, they came back to the hospital with other symptoms. So this, actually, these new things are coming up. If it is not very sure that what are the organs that can be damaged, lungs, yes, it is shown that lungs, definitely COVID attacks the lungs, but the other organs which can be damaged, so the time will tell, and even we are not sure, we need to be hopeful that it is, the cure means a cure, but we need to keep a watchful eye that the people who are surviving the COVID infections, whether they are developing any other problem later on in their life or not. Time can answer well.
Thank you, sir. That's it from our interview session.
Thank you, madam, and thank you, everybody, for this.
Okay, now we are concluding our session for today. Special thanks to our three resource persons, Professor Gopibandhu Misra, Dr. Shukumar Chattopadhyay, and Dr. Kushal Banerjee. We have heard the concept and from hygiene in Vedic tradition and in modern medical science too. We are very much benefited with this lecture. And thanks to all the participants for staying with us. Tomorrow we will be joining again in this platform at 3 p.m. sharply. The feedback form will be given on the chat box at the end of the day two. I repeat, at the end of the day two. Thanks to all. See you again.